Thank you.
Welcome to my presentation about monitoring with Nagios and CheckMK. I'm a freelance system administrator and programmer since 1998. So my career, I was often called to fix the server problem. And after I managed to fix it, I thought about what caused this issue. And in a number of cases, the whole accident could have been prevented by proper planning. For example, adding more disk space to the server. So in other cases, it would have been possible to predict the problem. Because again, in the example with the disk space, you see that the disk space gets smaller and smaller and smaller. And if you have some kind of monitoring, you can detect the situation and handle it before it causes a big problem. And often, rather small problems turn into a crisis if you just ignore it and let it run. So I started pretty early with monitoring my servers and the servers of my customers. And at this time, the only really open source solution was Nagios. And it's still a really, really good software for that. And a few years ago, I added the CheckMK add-on to Nagios, which made my life and the life of my customers much easier. So some of the key questions for monitoring is, why do you do monitoring? I already said a few reasons. Who should do that, or who can do that? And a kind of difficult question is, what do you actually monitor? And that is not really obvious. So why do you want to do it? You want to check the availability of servers and the servers running on them. And for the server itself, you just send a ping. And if it comes back with echo, you say, OK, the server seems to work. But even if you are running to a situation where the server is out of memory, it will probably respond to the ping. And that isn't really much information about the health of the system. So you're going to check all the services which are important for you on the server, or which might turn into a problem. The main reason to do this ping thing is, in case the server is really down, like with a hardware error or something like that, you don't need to bother to check the services on it. And aside from checking your own server and services, your business or your life might depend on third-party services, which you have a contract with, and they say, okay, we offer you the services, and of course, everything works fine. But in reality, it can make problems, and you have to deal with them, and you want to really check that even this third-party service is working all the time. And there are these kinds of contracts called SLA, service level agreement, which say, okay, I give you the services and it will be online like 99.99%. And with monitoring, you can also verify that this statement is true. So who can do that? Of course, companies which run a business are the first which can really use monitoring. And in the age of everything is online, it's very important that nothing goes down, because your customers will be upset very quickly and might move to another company. It's also useful for open source projects, which providing some kind of service. I recently had this example of a conference tool for open source conferences, which went down and no one noticed this before the weekend, and there was running a conference, and that was really not funny. So, what do you want to check? There are a lot of possibilities, and I can't go into much detail. therefore I choose a use case of a mail server where doing just the basic checks you apply to any normal server, and then specific checks for mail server. And after that, I will show you a couple of other custom checks which might come to your mind. Okay. So a few examples for basic checks on a server is you check the CPU if it has enough resources to deal with all the processes. And you check the memory usage, which can be often be a problem if it goes out of memory, especially with servers in the cloud or Raspberry servers, which don't have much resources in regards of memory. So another thing is watching the number of TCP connections, because your server can only handle so much of them. And if you get more TCP connection than usual, it might be some kind of problem which you might detect. Yeah, and I already talked about the disk usage. So what kind of checks I'm doing for email server? Yeah, on the email server, you have usually running SMTP server, which receives email from other servers and sends them out. And you as a customer or a user of a mail server, you're using the IMAP or the old POP protocol to download your emails or view your emails. And if you are not at home, you might also using a webmail server. So for all these things, you're checking if this service is online, is responding. But even that is not enough. For example, the SMTP server might be answering, but if you really try to send an email, it might fail for a number of reasons. Wrong configuration or database not available, and on and on. And you might also have a problem with a number, too much connections again, because some of these servers have limits which you can exceed. So in general, the mail server is also a database with all the accounts and their passwords. And if this database has a problem, of course, the whole mail server is in trouble. So you want to check this too. Okay, but this is kind of obvious to check these things. Other things which can bring your mail server down if you don't, if they don't run properly anymore, are a scanner for viruses and a spam filter. So that can mean if the virus scanner is not available, you say, okay, I don't receive any emails because I don't want to get all the viruses in my system without check. And similar thing can happen with the spam filter. So you want to monitor them as well and see that they function properly. So for example, you will also want to check how many viruses are catched, because if there are none, there's really a problem with the virus scanner. So, and the mail server is a kind of query which contains any email message which can be sent at the moment. And usually, it's not very big. But if it gets bigger, that might indicate the problem. It could be that it's just a newsletter of your marketing department, which is sent to many, many recipients, and it takes time to deliver them all. That's more or less harmless, but you want to know about this as administrator. It can, again, be a configuration problem. Or one case I had a few times is you're also delivering emails for a web server. And there you have like WordPress installations, and they are hacked somehow, or their FTP accounts are hacked. And so you have servers with PHP worms on it. And these PHP worms had a basic SMTP server inside, and these were continuously sending emails. And you want to prevent that. And you see it if it's this, we have more messages in the query. That can be an indicator for that. And also, a situation you want to prevent is getting your mail server blacklisted. Blacklists contain IPs from servers where they're known to send spam, often coming from, dynamic allocated IPs. So you say, okay, that's a problem. If you are one of the big backlists, you might notice really soon that something is wrong. But there are a lot of blacklists around, and some of those blacklists are not used by a lot of people. But still, if your boss sends an email to someone which is really important to him and it doesn't get through, or for other people can send him email, that's a really bad situation you want to prevent. So this is all about the mail server. So general monitoring, you want to prevent as much problems as possible, and some of them are not really obvious. For example, you have long running jobs on your server, and if they finish, they send an email, all is fine. But sometimes they get stuck, or they running longer as you would think, but you don't get the email, and you just forget about it, and at some point, people are calling saying, what's wrong, what's happening? And this kind of situation you want to prevent. And you will predict them by monitoring. Another thing I did, I have a few stores which put their products on Amazon automatically, and their API to doing so is not so easy, and you can get problems when they throttle you or don't accept some data and stuff like that. And you can't really handle all these cases, so you just check, I have like 1,000 products marked for Amazon, and they should appear on Amazon's website, and you check how much are really there, and if it's a big difference, you say, okay, something is wrong, I have to investigate it. So crashes, and in general, log files. Sometimes you had the problem with your web application, there's a bug, but you wouldn't notice this because it just writes a log file, I'm crashed, or some error message, and it will be undetected. So, but you can also monitoring, you can make a process to just check these log files and looking at them and say, okay, this message matches the crash, and then I can do something about it. The next point is like importing files. Many of the shops I'm caring for, they're using import files from their ERP system to get the products up to date in their shop. And for one or another reason, these import files can be empty, they can be old, and this could be, and you have the wrong inventory in your shop, and people ordering products you don't have anymore. And also, underestimated situations are backups. You set up your backup and think everything is fine, but of course, there can be going something wrong, and if you're in a situation you want to restore something and your backup is invalid, you are really out of your wits. So you're doing monitoring if the backups are there, if they're not too old, and if they are correct. There are many more examples. Also, if you have a MySQL master-slave setup, it can be that the slave at some point loses track of the master. That's not a big problem. You can go on slave and check the situation and maybe just jump over one statement and start it again. But if you don't know this is, and you need to use the slave, you might just rebuild the slave because it's totally outdated. Okay. As I said, I use Nagios for most of my customers on my servers. So I will talk about the advantages of Nagios. How do you use the checks on Nagios and certain disadvantages which you have in Nagios when you have a standard installation. So the advantages are Nagios is pretty flexible. You have a lot of plugins, add-ons, and all that stuff. And you can change a lot of things. This is a very sophisticated configuration options. The plugins, which are the checks, are a really simple model. They can be any program, a script, and they just give some output, and out of the output, Nagios sees if the service is okay or if it might be turned bad in the near future. And it's pretty much easy to write these checks or plugins. There's a big community around Nagios. There are a lot of people which wrote plugins and add-ons, and you can download them and use in your Nagios installation. So how do the checks work? First of all, every check for monitoring is a plugin in Nagios. There are a number of plugins which are coming with a Nagios installation, like the check HTTP checks your web server. And as I said, you can use any programming language to write these checks, which is quite convenient, and they are not really complicated. Also, Nagios distinguishes between active checks and passive checks. With the active checks, Nagios goes to the server and asks him about the services which are running there and collects this information. And he's doing this one by one for every service. While with the passive checks, he gets the results sent by the server in question and then processes the results. So with Nagios, you have four check states. The first one is okay, everything is fine. The next one is warning. That means, there might be something wrong. Please look at it. And the third state is critical. So Nagios saying, okay, this service is not working anymore. You have problems, you have to check it. Kind of unrelated to that is unknown. This state is detected by Nagios. If you can't detect the real state, if this plugin is misconfigured or the service cannot be found, or there's a number of reasons which can be used for the state. So you have two examples for the output of a check in Nagios. In the first case, you have a web server. He says, OK, everything's OK. Then you have some text with it, how many bytes the response were and the time. And the last line with the pipe. After the pipe is some performance data you can use for graphs. And the second thing, you get a 404. That means there's no real content delivered by your web server, and that ends up in a warning state. So you can do with the performance data, you can do performance graphs. Over time, we see what's happening. So this web server is really well behaved. It doesn't deviate from the normal response time. So what are the disadvantages of Nagios today, of the standard installation? There was a recent survey in the German Linux magazine, and they talked to a lot of companies which are using Nagios, also bigger companies, and some of them went to another system, or they used CheckMK and so on, and the most common disadvantages happened in environments with a lot of servers and services to watch, which is more common nowadays with all the servers running in the cloud instead using a big server. And these two points were, first of all, the configuration is done with text files. And if you have a lot of servers, it's difficult to manage, and you quickly lose the big picture. And the scalability in large environments isn't so good, because by standard, Nagos uses the ethic check, and if it have to do too much active checks, you can't do the checks in time, and then the monitoring is not accurate anymore. Okay, but just these important points can be alleviated if you're using the CheckMK add-on, which solves these problems and brings you a lot of other good new features for CheckMK. So I'm talking about the features, what kind of components CheckMK has, and at the end, some piece of practical advice. So first of all, the feature, it has the automatic service detection. CheckMK has an agent which is running on the monitor server, and the agent just determines the usual checks without the need you to configure by your own. It has a rule-based hierarchical configuration, and it has a much higher performance because it uses passive checks. So the agent runs all the checks on its own and collects information and then sends them back to Nagos to the CheckMK server in a big batch. And so you can handle much more servers. And also it creates the Nagos configs for you. So, okay. So it has a configuration check engine. It has a live status component, so you can better display all the performance data and watch it over time. It has a multi-site component, so it can work in a cascaded environment where it has many monitoring servers which are all delivering the data to the main server. It has a Veto, which is basically an administration tool where you have a GUI for all the services and for users, which can see the services. And that about the most important components. And the architecture is you have the host, there sits the agent, which determines the current state and sends all the data to CheckMK, which also saves the results in a IRD database, which is a round-robin database, and then gives all the collected information back to Nagos. So, okay. And you can do this with the Veto tool, but you can also do it on command line. So the CheckMK server has to know which servers are running on the monitor server, so you can make an inventory with the CheckMK command. And then the first one is to get information about new services, and the second one is updating the services. And you always can do the reload, so it updates the configuration of Nagos and is restarting the Nagos server. Okay. So this works really well, but in this new scenario with CheckMK, you have to think about two things. You have to check the execution time of your checks. So if your checks really takes a long time, you don't get any information about your service at all. And some checks are not needed any time the agent is running. For example, if you know your import file is updated every half an hour, it's okay if your check is just every half hour. Okay. So the other thing is you can use status file instead of running the whole check. And in CheckMK, you can also cache checks. Okay. Any questions?
Thank you. Any questions? Hi, Juan. How large is the largest installation of Next.js you have?
It's not very big. It's about 100 servers.
100 servers. Cool. Thank you.